Started. I was supposed to testify this morning. The word came through about the anointed prayer of his people and in the prayer clause. And I just am so stirred up because we came up here on Christmas Eve and we prayed a prayer call for my cousin Rowan. And I don't know if y'all were here or not. Before, when I came in, I got a call from my mother who had talked to my aunt, and he was born. His blood levels were very low. He was yellow. He was supposed to have four lights on him to keep him warm. The hospital that he was in only had two, and he wasn't in well enough condition to be transferred. Let me tell y'all, at the power of the prayer that was prayed, by the time I left this building, they were sending him home. So God hears you and he loves you.
Thank you. the boast of sin and grave. Oh, he silences it. Do you hear me? Oh, there's nothing that the name of Jesus doesn't cover. There's nothing that his sacrifice on that cross didn't do for you. Oh, I'm telling you, you don't have to fear sin. You don't have to fear death. You don't have to fear the grave, because the name of Jesus has set you free. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Death could not hold you. Let's go. Death could not hold you. The veil.
We're so glad to have Brother Ben Fugatt here tonight. Y'all make him feel welcome as he comes to minister to us. Just obey the Lord, brother.
There's a song that's been on my heart for about a week now. My wife, every time I start to open my mouth, she's like, "Are you going to sing that song again?" I said, "Yes, I am." It says, "As the world looks upon me, as I struggle alone, they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. See, in my heart, I'm rejoicing. Oh, I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing on me. There's a roof up above me. I've got a good place to sleep. There's food on my table. And see, there's shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing on me." See, these clothes, they're not new. And even these shoes, they're a little dirty and scuffed up. I had my trials this week and I come through, but you know what? Jesus, he was still there. I lost loved ones this week, dear friends, but you know what? When soon as I hear the trumpet sound, I can say I'll meet them in glory. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. My God, I feel the anointing. There's a roof up above me. I've got a good place to sleep. There's food on my table, and there's shoes on my feet. See, he gave me his love, and oh, a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing on me. Sing that chorus one more time. There's a roof up above me. I've got a good place to sleep. There's food on my table. There's shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing on me. God, I thank you for this day, God, and I thank you for your anointing. God, I thank you, God, that you're going to saturate this place like never before, God. God, I thank you, God, that today is the day that some of us are going to put Jesus on top of our situation, God. God, that your anointing is going to flow like never before in our lives, God. That we're going to experience a season of above and beyond like we've never experienced before, God. God, I thank you, God, that there's a shaking coming to this county, God. God, and it's starting with us. I thank you for your anointing, God. I thank you for completely removing me out of the way, God, and letting me speak as you would have me to speak, God. God, I thank you and I praise you for the Holy Ghost and what it's going to do in this place, God. We give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I dare you to release the sound in this place. Stand to your feet and open your mouth and begin to say thank you, Jesus. Begin to thank him for his anointing. Tonight we're going to start off in Matthew. I was telling Brother Aaron last night, we're going to be at Matthew 15, or 14, I'm sorry, 14, that I believe that God has given me a word. I prayed and I sought after him when I got the call. I told my wife, I said, they messaged me. She said, they did. I said, I had to ask myself, did they realize who they messaged? I was caught off guard, and I said, I began to pray, and I'm a firm believer in this pulpit is holy. It's holy. If you're going to stand behind this pulpit, you better release nothing but the sound word of God. That should be all that's released from up here. And so I begin to seek God, and I begin to ask God, what do you want me to say, Jesus? What do you want me to say? I don't have words to say. I don't know what to say to these people. And he began to speak to me, and he began to tell me something that really shocked me. He said, am I on top of your situation?
Oh, yeah.
I said, well, I try to keep you on top of everything. And when I realize I messed up, I repent and I ask you to get on top of it. He said, open up your Bible and begin to read. And he took me to Matthew chapter 14. And we're going to start with verse 22. It says, and straightway Jesus constructed his disciples to get into a ship and go before him upon the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And he went, and when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into the mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was alone there. But the ship was in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves from the winds. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, Is it a spirit? And they cried out in fear. But straightway Jesus spoke unto them, saying, Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come to thee on the water. And Jesus said, Come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to Jesus. But when he saw the winds blistered, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou faith? And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, Of a truth, thou art the Son of God. And when they were gone over, they came into the land of, I'm not sure how to say that word, so we're going to say the G word. So, as I begin to read this, I begin to ask God, okay, we already know this story. Everybody knows this story. This is an elementary story. This is something that we learn when we are in the youngest classes of Sunday school. I remember learning this, and we learned a song that my cousin wrote. It said, step out of the boat, walk on the water. Step out of the boat, walk on the sea. And so, like, we had our little dance moves, and we were the stuff back then. I was probably about 5 or 6 when I learned this story. And so I was like, God, this is just an elementary story. This is something so simple that we all can get. And he began to speak to me. He said, you're not looking at the story right. He said, when I put something there, I want you to look at it from every aspect of life, because not all of us have the same walk. Some of us will experience stuff that none of other people will ever want to experience. So we have to be able to look at the scripture from every aspect of life. What is it saying? What is God saying to us at that moment? You may read John 3:16 right now as a beginner in the walk, and it speak to you volumes about the love of Christ. And after you get older, you realize the love of Christ goes even more deeper, and you develop the love of the Father. And so we've got to pay attention to the Word of God. As I was reading, it says, one of the things that caught my eye was it says it was in the fourth hour of the night. So that means that when Jesus went up to the mountain praying, when he come to them, he was coming to them between the hours of 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. Jesus began to spend time in prayer, and he spent time in prayer for real. The manifestation of God himself in flesh spent time in prayer. We've got to spend time in prayer. We've got to know how to pray. I was telling my wife on the way over here, I told her, I said, you know, I said, the word is a bullet. It's a weapon of mass destruction if you know how to use it just right. But what good is a bullet without a gun? The bullet is the action of it. The prayer is putting it into the, taking the word, putting prayer into your word is like putting a bullet into a gun and shooting the gun. You do more damage that way. But you've got to have prayer time. That's your communication with God. It says, when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, is it a spirit? And they cried out in fear. Well, I went and looked through all the books of the Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and I tried to look for this story and make sure I had everything lined up. In every part of this book, it says disciples were scared. It said they were frightened when they saw Jesus. When Jesus was walking upon them, they were frightened, and they cried out in fear. There's something, this new move of God that's coming into the land, it's going to frighten us at first. Amen. Because it's going to be so deep that it's going to shock us. Amen. we're going to say, wait, is this really God? Is this really God? And I'm here to tell you, God is going to confirm himself, because he spoke out. He said, be not afraid. There's things that's taking place. Y'all, this is the first time in my life I ever remember this many murders in this county. That's a lot of murders. Did y'all know in November alone, just November, there were 47 cases of overdoses from heroin. Just heroin. And that's not counting meth. That's just heroin. 47 cases. The enemy's on attack. He's got the sea raging right now. And we're sitting in a boat. The body of Christ is sitting in the boat. We're looking. What are we doing? Are we panicking? Are we scared of the move of God that we have to step into? Or are we stepping into it? I believe God has spoke to me, because there's too many Christians sitting there going, oh, this is just horrible. This is just bad. I don't know what's wrong with this generation. I don't know why they don't have an understanding of Jesus. Well, you're not stepping out of the boat to show them something. We've got our plain religion, and we want to keep to ourselves and not get out of it. That's what's wrong with the body of Christ. He never called you just to be in the church. Your first calling is to be a witness, to go out and win souls. A lady told me, she said, well, I'm not called to preach, and I can't sing. I said, where's your witness? Where's it at? That should be the first thing you're doing. Hey, I was a sinner. I was a drug addict. I was talking to my mother-in-law today, and she was talking to me about some stuff. And I told her, I said, I think back to the things that I did, and I think to myself, how in God's name did I live? As many times as I got in that car and I drove around like an idiot, drunk, how did I survive? God kept his hand on me. But it took somebody stepping outside of their boat and saying, hey, Ben, you need Jesus. Your problems can't be solved until you have Jesus. We talked with a little girl last night. She said, I don't know about Jesus. I don't know. I said, Jesus is the ultimate lover. He fills that hole inside your soul that nothing else can fill. I've had plenty enough alcohol to try to fill it. It didn't fill it. I had plenty enough drugs, but it didn't fill it. It took the Spirit of God to fill it. There's a generation waiting to hear us say, hey, you need Jesus. We don't have to tell them what they're doing is wrong. They know that's wrong. They know. They need to know that, hey, in spite of you being a homosexual, in spite of you being a drug addict, in spite of you being who you are, a drunkard, God still loves you. He doesn't judge you for who you are. He doesn't see you as a homosexual. He sees you as a finished product. He sees you as a tool that he can use for the kingdom. Amen. Jesus said beside a well, woman, come up. Drawing water. She's just going about her normal everyday routines. She didn't know she was going to have this meeting of a lifetime. She had five husbands. She divorced all of them. Every last one of them divorced. Man she's living with, she's living in sin. She knew it. Did Jesus have to tell her? No. She knew she was in sin. She knew it. Jesus looked at her and said, the water that I have, you'll never thirst again. He didn't look at her and say, you're bound for a devil's hell. You're good for nothing. He simply said, here's what I have to offer. The Bible says that when Peter called out, he said, Jesus bid me come. And Jesus said, come. Then the Bible, it cracks me up how it stressed this. It said, and Peter was come down out of the ship and walked on the anointing. Amen. On the water. God spoke to me last night. He said, you got to come out of the mindset that you're in now and into a mindset of the Spirit to be able to walk onto the anointing. We have to change our mind. It doesn't matter what we look at, what we look like, what we have to offer. As long as our mind is stepping into a spiritual realm, then we're able to walk. See, Peter's faith was at the fullest that it could be then. It wasn't much faith. But when Jesus said, come, Peter said, okay. Down out of the boat he went. He went immediately. God is calling some of you to ministry. He's saying, I'm waiting on you to step out. This is the first time for me. Me and my wife talked. I said, 2015, oh, it was horrible, man. It's so horrible right there towards the end. I lost my granddaddy tragically, unexpectedly. It hurt. 2016 rolled around that January. We lost not one, but two grandmothers at one time. It was, what, 2 days apart? Exactly 2 days apart. Gone. We thought, well, they can't get much worse. We will stand no matter what, because we'll just stand. We experienced two miscarriages. And one of them was far enough along to know that we had twins. Me and Jessica, we held on to our faith. We weren't going to be shaken. We got pregnant again. Was excited. Saw the ultrasound, sit down in the room. I got to see my little baby's heartbeat. I was so excited. We went along, and when she was about 20 weeks, she gave birth to our little baby. And it went home to be with Jesus. And that, I'll never forget that day. I'll never forget it, Aaron. It's still scarred in my mind. I remember we went to go get Jax. And Jessica was sitting in there, and we got home. She said, I think I just had the baby. I said, what? We're walking across the yard, and I've got a handful of food. And I was like, what? She said, I think I just had our baby. I said, stand right there, just stay still. I said, I ran into the house, set everything on the counter. I came in, I helped her into the house. She walks into the restroom and she calls me, and I walk in there and she said, here's our baby. And there laid my baby. It wasn't very big. It's about the longest my palm, about as long as my hand. You could see all the ribs and stuff and the little eyes. It had little fingers and toes. And I looked down and I thought, why? Why? Why me? I've been faithful to the church. I went when I was sick. Sick as a dog, I've been faithful to the church. I've done this all my life. I gave my life back to you. I've been scarred. I've had churches talk about me. Men of God look at me in my face and tell me I was nothing. But I still stood. I stood. Yes. Why me? And I looked at my wife, and my wife began to get weak. And I panicked. I didn't know what to do. I walked in the kitchen. I sat down at the table, and it's like I snapped. And I immediately opened my biscuit and began to eat. And my granddad is like, Ben, Ben. And he said he called me 6 times. I only heard him 1 time. And when I came to myself, I realized what was going on, and I called 911, and my wife sat in the hospital for 8 hours, bleeding. 8 hours. So here I am again, standing there, and I just lost my baby, and now I'm fixing to lose my wife. She's bleeding to death right in front of me. And the doctor's not really doing anything. They're panicking themselves. They don't know what to do. The doctor himself told me and my wife, we don't understand what happened. We don't know how this happened. And I'm standing there and I said, God, you said you'd give me peace that surpasses understanding. If you're going to move from me, you need to move from me now. Because I don't know how much more I could take. And we began to stand there and we just held on to what little faith we had. And at the end of the day, after everything was said and done, we was fixing to go home. The nurse came in. She said, y'all remain so calm. What happened? I was in my boat. My sea was raging all around me. I had a choice right there in that moment. Do I stay in my boat or do I step out? I stepped out. I said, the Bible says he'll give me peace that surpasses all understanding. She said, what do you mean by that? I said, though though I'm hurting and I'm confused, I said, though I feel like I can't go on, I said, my God is still holding on to me. He's got me wrapped in his arms right there in this moment. I said, and he even performed a miracle for me. She said, well, what's that? I said,
come on.
My wife should be dead right now. She bled for 8 hours. 8 hours she bled. I'm talking about really bleeding. We're not talking about no small cut bleeding. My wife should have been dead. I said, but my God kept her for me. He kept her for me. And he said, no, not today. Your purpose is not done. He said, you've got to live another day. It may be hard right now, but continue on in my word. Hold on to me, and I will bring you out.
Yes, hallelujah.
She said, oh my, I've been church all my life, but I never seen the love of God that way. What was I doing? I was ministering to her. I was showing her, hey, even though your situation may be hard, ours might not compare, but your situation still matters, but you can carry on.
Yes.
With the word. God is calling us. Your situation may be hard at this moment. Seas may be raging all around you, but he's saying, I need you to step out of your situation and let Jesus be on top of it all. Another thing I brought up to Brother Aaron, and I went back and I double checked myself, Brother Aaron, too. Where in the scripture, I read it to you, where did you see that Peter was swimming? Anybody see that Peter was swimming? Did y'all hear it? Because Matthew's the only one where it talks about where Peter stepped out on the water. Matthew's the only one. He does it. We don't see him swimming, do we? God spoke to me. He said, I didn't call you to sink. He said, I didn't even call you to swim. Amen. Why are you swimming? He said, "You, some of y'all in the water just backstroking away, having a fun time. He said, I didn't call you to backstroke. He said, I didn't call you to swim. I called you to walk on the water. The Bible says that Peter, when he was walking on the water, his focus was on Jesus. He could walk. Is when he began to look at his problems and his situations and begin to ask himself, what's going on right here, is when he began to sink. God said, swimming is the same as saying, God, I know your plan, I know what you want to do, but I'm going to do it myself. That's what he told me. He said, that makes you no better than the Ephesians. He said, they had a plan. They knew the word. They were educated. In that time, Ephesus was the place to go if you wanted to learn something. All the apostles had spent time there. The know of the know was in Ephesus. The Bible says they left their first love. How'd they leave their first love? They started worrying about the work instead of the worker. Let me explain. Jesus is the master potter. If he is the master potter, that means his hands have to shape the clay and make the pot, right?
Yeah.
Well, me as a Christian, if I get so caught up in ministry that I forget to put Jesus in first, I'm basically pushing the hands of the potter away, and I, the pot, am trying to mold myself. That's what I'm trying to do. We see that a lot in the body of Christ. I did it in my own life. I said, God, I don't see you moving, so I'm going to push anyways. Determination is an important part of a Christian lifestyle, but when your determination takes over the will of God, then there's a problem. The will of God is a special thing. His hands are special because they know how to shape you. He said, there's a lot of people in the body of Christ saying, I'm going to win my son. I'm going to win my daughter. I'm going to make sure they come to Jesus Christ. But the entire time, they're forgetting to put Jesus in the midst of their witnessing to them. So they're driving them further away.
Yeah.
The church has a special ability to win souls. We, everyone in here has a special ability to be influential. That just comes with being a Christian. Growing up, I found myself being able to talk to people because I spent time in the church, and I learned if you know how to speak and what words to use and how to talk, you can, now I'm just going to say it, you can manipulate a person into anything. There's a lot of preachers doing it right now behind the pulpits as we speak tonight. All across the nation, they're manipulating the people into something because they're determined to get something. They're pushing Jesus out of the way, and they're swimming as hard as they can. I don't have to manipulate you. I don't. I just have to tell you the truth. The truth can change your heart. All I have to do is speak. Why do we have to force people into the church? We don't. If we're keeping our focus on Jesus, your anointing will go to a place that you've never experienced before. You won't have to struggle. Me and my wife lived in a house, and this bad person lived next door. He got accused of being a pedophile. Had meth head friends that was banging on our house. They was putting us through torture. It was awful. I could not go to work on third shift without my wife calling me at least three times a night. Am I lying, baby? It wasn't because Jessica was just a scared cat. It's because Jessica feared for her life because they started getting crazy. And they were coming to our windows, putting flashlights in our windows, searching the house. They even went as far as like breaking into our power box outside and hooking up power and running to their little shed so that they can have power. They were crazy. And I told Jessica, I said, we're just going to struggle. We're just going to keep it holding on. Then the Spirit of God said, why should you live in torment? Ask me. Ask me. I said, God, I can't live in this torment. I need you to deliver me out of this situation. I stood to the side, and I let him handle the situation. Within one day, we found a house within our budget, and we was able to completely move, get all the down payment for the house, first month's rent, and we did it within 2 days. God moved for us. Now imagine what would happen if I decided just to stay and struggle through it. You're not called to struggle. You're not called to swim. Give your situation to Christ and let him take care of it. And the final point I'm going to make, it says, on verse 31, and immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? In the New King James Version, it says, oh ye of little faith, why do you doubt? Why do you doubt? I told my wife, I said, that's the biggest thing that stuck out to me. Why am I doubting? Why am I doubting? The Greek word for doubt is dystazira. Dystazil. Dystazil is how you would say it. Dystazil. And it means to waver or to hesitant in belief. Hesitant in belief. That one has caught my attention. As soon as I seen it, it caught my attention. Means to hesitant in belief. Why should I hesitate on what God's doing? This move of God, teenagers, when it comes, it's going to shock you. Don't be hesitant to move. Don't. Don't be hesitant. If you hesitate, you'll miss it. That's a word from the God. If you hesitate, you'll miss it. Don't hesitate. Take your opportunity and run with it. God is fixing to stir this nation. And I told my wife, I said, at the beginning of the year, God spoke to me. He said, there'll be three things that happen to the United States before the coming of Christ. It'll be three major disasters. And it will shake the United States like it's never shook the United States before. And God spoke to me. He said, the Dow will not be able to replace itself. Stock markets will fall. It will be as if we went to the Great Depression again. He said, this will happen before the coming of Christ. And I said, okay. He said, but in the midst of all the disaster, there'll be a remnant to rise up that will shake the nation back to the heart of God. We are experiencing this now. There's a remnant that's rising up. I've seen it on TV where they're talking about kids in Kentucky, school shutting down because they're having church, for real Pentecostal church. Souls being won to the body of Christ. Perry Stone talked about his barn, his youth barn. I've been watching it. Every weekend, teenagers showing up and praying until they have a breakthrough of the Holy Ghost. Praying. I told my teens last Wednesday night, I said, we're going to learn how to pray this year. We're going to learn how to pray through like the old saints did. That's something we forgot how to do, is pray through. One of my mothers in Christ, she told me, she said, son, did God answer you? When I said, I don't know, she said, go pray some more. When I received the Holy Ghost, the old man, Brother J.W. Powell, stood on the platform, and one of my friends asked, did I get the Holy Ghost yet? He said, if you have to question it, go pray some more. Yeah. He said, the move of God is not questionable. You will know when you got it. The move of God that is landing in this land, people are going to know it was nothing but God. It's separating the evil from the truth. Because I'm telling you right now, there's so many false prophets speaking words that they have no clue of what they're speaking. But there's real men and women of God standing up telling them, shut your mouth. That is not the word of God. The word of God to this land right now is repent. Find Jesus. Find salvation and come to the bleeding side of Calvary. Pentecostal churches don't even know what Pentecost is no more. But there's a remnant rising up saying, I've got to speak in tongues. I've got to speak in tongues to know that I have the Holy Ghost. I've got to see the movement of God. Signs are not following us because we don't believe for real. But there's a remnant saying, I've got to do this until I see these signs. I've got to see them. Are you a part of the remnant? And I'm not just speaking to the teens. I'm speaking to the entire church. Are you a part of the final remnant? Is your heart shaking? When was the last time you had a real shaking of the Holy Ghost? How can we call ourselves Pentecostals and not have a shaking of the Holy Ghost? I serve a God of Acts. When they spoke in tongues and people began to come and they say, hey, you're speaking my language. What is the goodness of God? That's the kind of Pentecostal I am. And I will not give up until I see salvation in my county. I will not give up until I see revival in my state. I don't care what politicians say. They are not in charge. Jesus is in charge. So they can talk all they want to up there. They can say all they want to do and release bills and stuff like that. But God is going to shake his nation one last time. He's going to shake us. He's going to shake us. So in closing, and as we stand, musicians, I don't know. Is Jesus on top of your situation? Is Jesus the one that's helping you walk right now? Are you struggling to stay afloat? Or do you find yourself swimming because you just don't want to sink? Is he on top of your situation? Are you brave enough to step outside of the boat and minister to somebody and give them what Jesus has given you? I'm not saying that it's going to be easy. I ain't going to say that there's going to be times you question yourself, because we're human. That's still going to be there. But in the end, are you going to say, I give it to you, Jesus. I give it to you. As hard as mine and my wife's situation was, and as much as I wanted to hold a grudge towards God and say, God, it's all your fault, I said, no, I will follow Christ to my dying breath. I will stand when nobody else will stand. Even if my wife won't stand with me, I will stand alone. Is he on top of your situation? Because I don't know about you, I can't make it without him. I can't live this life without him. I would go insane. I really would. I need Jesus. Tonight, I don't know many of y'all. I just know of a few select of y'all through New Haven. So I'm going to ask this question. If the clouds was split right now, and Jesus stepped forth and he put one foot on land and the other on water, and he said, come home, would you be numbered in the number? Do you know for sure that Jesus would take you home? Without a shadow of a doubt, do you know for sure Jesus would take you home? Because that's what I'm here for mostly tonight. I believe that God's going to bring breakthrough tonight, but I need to know that if there's a lost soul here, that you will join me in heaven. Hell is a for real place, and I do not wish it on anyone. I don't wish it on my worst enemy. And I need to know that you can make it. If that's you and you don't know, these altars are open. I want you to come. And me and these leaders will pray for you until we know for sure that you have found Jesus. Until you can say, yes, I'm going to heaven. If that's you, I ask you to come. God, I thank you for this day, God. And I thank you for this sermon, God. I thank you for allowing me to be used. God, if there be a lost soul here, God, I ask you to bring conviction. God, bring them to the bleeding side of Calvary, God. God, I don't know everyone here. I don't know their heart and how they stand. God, I don't know if they had a relationship with you then decided to back off from you. God, but if they be lost, I ask you to begin to deal with them, Jesus. Because if I leave here knowing that I didn't ask, God, I know I failed you. God, I ask you to begin to move, Jesus. God, I thank you, Jesus. God, I thank you, Jesus. I thank you for your presence, Jesus. God, there's none like you, Jesus. God, there is none like you, Jesus. God, if there be none among them, God, I call out to those that are inside the boat right now, God, questioning you, which way to go. If you're inside the boat, God, I ask you to come down here right now and let God begin to move upon you. Let him draw you out. Call out his name and ask him to call you. Because just like Peter, he'll say, come. He's just waiting on you to take the step. Maybe you don't have the Holy Ghost and you need the Holy Ghost. I'm willing to pray with you till you get the Holy Ghost. My job ain't done until you get the Holy Ghost. Maybe you just need strength for this new season. And life's been hard and you found yourself being the one that was sinking. Or trying to swim. And you just need prayer for strength. I'm willing to pray for you. Like I said, I know the struggle. And I know the struggle is real. And sometimes it gets hard, and it seems like it's more than we can bear. But I'm a witness that you can make it through. He's waiting on you to say, here I am, Jesus. To stretch forth your hand and say, here I am, so he can pull you up. Call and I'm going to turn it back over to the pastor. I want all the teens to come and begin to line up, and I want all the leaders to come and stand behind them. we're going to pray for Holy Ghost fire and strength, because I believe that God's fixing to shape this county, and he's going to have to use y'all. I'm going to tell you, it's not going to be easy sometimes. The devil knows how to talk to you. He knows how to make you question yourself, because that's what he's good at. That's what he's designed for. He's the opposite of God. He wants to bring destruction, and God wants to bring life. And so I want y'all to understand, there's life in your hands. There's life in your tongue. That when you speak, you can bring life. And I'm going to pray that there'll be no fear in your heart, that when school time comes and they begin to ask you the questions, how can I be saved? That you step outside the boat and that you run and you snatch up that soul and you run it into the cross. Yes. God's going to use you for revival. And right now, in the name of Jesus, I break every spirit of doubt that would come to their mind. I rebuke the enemy right now in the name of Jesus. Every generational curse that would be on their hearts from the past, right now in the name of Jesus, we break. God, begin to feel right now in the name of Jesus. Pour out a fire upon them, God. They are not their parents, they are greater. Right now in the name of Jesus. We call greatness into their lives. I call anointing into their lives, God, right now in the name of Jesus. Anointing right now in the name of Jesus. Strength in the name of Jesus. They don't have to be like the world. The world wants to be like them. They can stand when it seems like it's too hard to stand. Every temptation that comes against them, we cast it down in the name of Jesus. We call greatness right now in the name of Jesus. I speak the word of God over each and every one of them, God. God, you begin to move right now in the name of Jesus. God, I thank you, Jesus. God, I thank you for your anointing, God. I call the Acts 2:38 fire upon them, God, to shake and push them forth, Jesus. God, we thank you, God, for what you're doing, Jesus. We thank you for your anointing, God. We thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father. Begin to press, teens. Don't stop now. Begin to press until you feel him shaking you like never before. Because there's anointings that's coming upon you. There's anointings that's coming upon you. New anointings to sing. That when you begin to sing, that demons begin to shake. And they begin to fear because of the anointing on your life. There's words being put into you. Prophetic words. I see the anointing to preach upon some of you. God, I praise you, Jesus.
No weapon formed against you shall prosper, Jesus. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. In Jesus' name, Son of God, Son of God, Son of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. 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 God. God, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name with him. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Yes, amen. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Seek God long as you want to seek Him. Seek God long as you want to seek Him. Seek Him. Worship Him long as you want to. Worship God as long as you want to worship Him. We're not in a hurry. Take your time. Worship God. Receive what you need to receive. Don't leave until you're satisfied. Don't leave until you're satisfied completely in the Lord. Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. young people in unity as one. You're a mighty force against the powers of darkness and the devil. And the enemy is afraid of what you will do for God as one, even though there's just 10 of you. Just 10 right now. But 10 plus 10 is 20. 10 plus 10 and plus 10 is 30. Plus 30 is 60. Plus 60 is 120 of you. Praise God. Believe God as one. Be united as one. Be united as one. Be united as one. Be united as one. And pray one for another. Pray one for another. Ask God to touch each of you. And remember, call out the names of each person in this line. Every person in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Call every name out to God in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Pray for Nathan. Pray for Stephen. Pray for Colton. Pray for Alan. Pray for Jonathan. Pray for Dr. Hill here. And pray for Rachel. Pray for Erica and Destiny. Call their names in prayer and believe God to touch them. Your prayer will strengthen that brother or sister in the Lord that's in this line. Your prayer will strengthen that brother or sister in the Lord in this line. Your prayer will strengthen that brother or sister that's in this line. You may think, well, what good will my prayer do? You can touch God as good as any adult in this place or anywhere else. Your prayer is just as powerful and potent and important. And you've got the authority in the Word of God to pray that prayer of faith in Jesus' name. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We're going to pray for Becky as a point of contact. If you'll come on up, brother. Come on up, and we're going to pray for Becky tonight that God will touch her. And young people, I want you to help me pray for his wife, Becky. Pray healing on her in Jesus' name as we come. Let's believe God to touch and heal her. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray for healing for Becky now. Afflict her and affliction, leave her body. Chains of affliction fall off her body. The strength that has been stolen from her, restore. Restore her strength and restore healing to her body, to her mind, her spirit, her soul, her being. Make her whole. God, drive out the affliction, God, in Jesus' name. By your stripes, Becky is healed. By your stripes, Becky is made whole. By your stripes, Becky is strengthened in you, Lord. She is strengthened now, and we bless you for touching Becky and healing her, raising her up right now in the name Jesus, that your word is working and you've just ministered to her at home right now. Bless you, Lord. Thank you for what you just did in the name Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Touch my brother and give him the strength he needs to continue on for you in Jesus' name. Praise you, God, in Jesus' name. Thank you, God, for your healing power for Becky tonight. It's done in Jesus' name. Praise God. Bless you, brother. Thank God. Bless you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Tell you, these young people, I love these young people. Not just these, all young people and children. We thank God for you. Young people, I want to tell you, this church is 100% behind you. Yes. We are 100% behind you. We're 100% behind you. And we're going to help you every way we possibly can. Every way of people can help young people, we're going to help you, our young people, because we love you. In Jesus' name, praise God. I wondered, these young people, anybody got a word you want to testify and say something good about Jesus? Hallelujah. Well, I praise God for something. I've got something good to say about Jesus. I'm a young person. Maybe stretching it a little bit. But I have been young. I'm not old now, but I'm older. 49 years ago, January the 26th, which I think that was Friday, I was preaching my first message at Alabama City Church of God. 49 years ago. Praise God. Hallelujah. I say to God be the glory for all that He's done. He's the one that did it all. Brother Ben, God bless you, son. We love you. Appreciate you. God's using you. Bless you, wife. Praise God for you. Praise God for a faithful wife. Amen. Thank the Lord. She's the best wife you've ever had. And the only wife. She'll see to that. She'll see that you're the only wife that you're ever going to have. And we love you. Thank you for coming tonight. We just praise God for you. And we just thank the Lord. God used you and blessed this body of believers, the young people, the adults, and young people. Just keep on seeking God in this altar. Keep praising the Lord. Keep seeking God. We'll be here till midnight and beyond if you need to. We'll be here, for we're not in a hurry. Amen. We don't have to punch a clock. Some of you may have to punch one, and you may have to leave, and I understand that, and that's fine. But we just worshiping the Lord, and we want our youth to praise and seek God until they're satisfied in Jesus. These are saved, young ladies. Young lady here, she's saved and sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, full of the power of God, but she's wanting more and more and more from God. And she's receiving it in Jesus' name. Praise God. You know, we can't receive too much.
Amen.
There is no too much that you can get from God. Can't get too much from Him. I praise God for it. Would you just reach your hand toward Rachel now? Let's pray a prayer especially for her. Father, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. I wish we had 1,000 like her. Praise the Lord. Wonderful, precious, holy young lady of God that walks with Jesus. Praise God. I tell you, it's wonderful. All these 10 young people that are up here walking with God, loving Jesus, we've got something to be thankful for. I praise God for it. We've got more young people that's not able to be here tonight. But we praise the Lord for every one of them, and we bless them in Jesus' name. I praise God for our youth mentor team as they're actively engaged in ministering to our youth, young people, that God's using them to encourage them, strengthen them, build them up on this most holy faith. And I just bless them in Jesus' name. Some of them are out because of sickness, and we understand that. And we just praise the Lord for those of you that are here. Thank you, adults that are here to worship the Lord. Praise God. God bless you. I appreciate you so much for coming. In Jesus' name, God bless you. Thank you.